The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Will you please rise for the call to worship? Jesus is the door to the kingdom within, from which all healing flows.
And he himself is the chief cornerstone. The ego cannot accept. Only the humble can enter through that door.
Repentance begins with the path of self-interest, fails us, as it most assuredly will, and we find ourselves in need of forgiveness.
Humility is the door to all good things. When we are humbled, we will finally forgive. When we are humbled, we learn to move Jesus from a belief to our Lord.
And our first hymn is number 201. Join me now in the invocation. We praise your abiding guidance, O God, for you sent us Jesus, our teacher and Messiah, to model for us the way of love for the whole universe. We offer these prayers of love on behalf of ourselves and our neighbors, on behalf of your creation and our fellow. Please join me now in the Church's covenant. We covenant with the Lord and with one another, and do bind ourselves in the presence of God to walk together in all his ways, according as he is pleased to reveal himself unto us in his blessed word of truth. We purpose to devote ourselves to the study, the practice, and the spread of Christianity. We will endeavor to be loyal to this fellowship, to help one another in the Christian life, to support the work and attend the meetings of this church according to our strength, ability, and opportunity, and in every way to strive to make it a power in the service of God and man. Pass the peace. Greet each other. What a pleasure to have all of you with us today. Welcome. We invite all of you to join us for Messy Church tonight from 5 to 7 p.m. This is intergenerational. There will be something for everyone. Mars is providing the food, fellowship, activities, and so forth. Guest speaker and entertainer Luke Winger will deliver the gospel next Sunday, April 14th. In an expressive and energizing fashion. You will not want to miss this, nor will your kids. More information is printed in the announcement insert. We welcome our visitors and hope that you will feel welcome and will join us again. There are welcome bags in the back of the church, and please leave your contact information.
As our children's pastor comes on out. They were shorter, yeah.
And I figured I was doing something wrong. Whoa, coming in hot. Good? Hi, guys.
Hi.
Oh, isn't that perfect? I only got 4 balloons. There's 4 of you. And this one matches your dress. And that one kind of matches your shirt. You've got the yellow. And you just match everything. You're so pretty. So we're going to make it really quick today. It's an easy one. So we're going to hear a little bit about Jesus on the cross. And something that's interesting, I don't know if a lot of people know, but depending on which of the Gospels you read in the Bible, Jesus' last words, they're different depending on which story you read. One thing, though, he does say, he talks about, is forgiveness. Even as he's dying on the cross, he's asking God to forgive the people that are doing this to him because they don't know what they're doing. Has anyone ever been super mean to you, and maybe your mom or dad or your grandparents says, well, you know, you have to forgive them? How does that feel? Is it easy to do? No. I have a hard time forgiving because I feel like if I do it, then, like, I'm losing. Does that make sense? It feels like I let them be wrong with me, and that doesn't feel good. So what we're going to do today, we're going to do it real fast. I'm going to let you guys, B, why don't you start, pick a balloon, and I want you to write something or someone that you think, you know, you want to have some forgiveness for them. Yeah, just write it on the balloon. Do you need me to help you spell Tommy's name? I'm just kidding, Tommy. You pick a name. You go ahead. Okay. Oh, well, that's kind of a nice problem to have. There's not enough hurt to have to forgive. All right. Did you want to take a turn there, Reese? Yeah, all right. Well, let Reese try it and you can think about it. Go ahead. Yeah, it's going to move a little bit. I think that's fair. There you go. Can you hold it still? Got it. B, did you think of anything? No. Did you want to write one for sister?
Sure.
You think for her. All right. B, if you don't have any problems, I'm going to take a whole balloon for myself. No? All right, let's see. Is the yellow one left? Oh. I was going to ask if his mom's name had one C or two. That's fine. There's room for you both. All right, so we have got our names or our hurts or our unforgiveness. They're up here on the balloons. Now, when we think about forgiveness, what we want to do, I think even though to me it feels like losing, like I have to forgive somebody that did something mean to me, and that just means like I'm letting them win. That's not true. So, this is what Jesus wants, and this is what happens on the cross when he finally passes, is he takes all of those hurts and everything that was wrong, and this is all that happens. He just gets to have it. And this weight that's holding down that balloon, all this weight, that's all that unforgiveness, the youth boys are going to get that down. It'll be fine. Did you want to go ahead and try to let go? Give a little forgiveness there? There's one more. We can let that one go. Did you want to get rid of your two there? There we go. Now that doesn't feel like losing. That's a nice thing, right? Well, you don't get to keep the balloons, but the balloons are, we'll get you some more. All right. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
I think you're more amused by the balloons. So we'll say a quick prayer. Bow with me. God, thank you for these kiddos. Thank you for, in times of uncertainty, we end up with four kids and four balloons, and just help us to always remember that these things that we need from you, that you always, in your perfect timing, and all your knowledge, give us what we need. In that same spirit, God, I ask that you would allow us to open ourselves up to where we have our unforgiveness, where maybe we might need to ask that forgiveness from others. And let us always just delight in the releasing and the letting go and letting you carry those for us. Amen. Thanks, ladies. And down there.
Thank you, Sandy. Okay. We will be taking a betting pool on what day they actually fall down. Our church does have a gambling license, so it's okay. We can. As far as our prayers for today, so far we've been asked to lift up both a thanks for the snowbirds that have returned and a prayer of safety and care for those who are still not quite home yet. We have a few joys this week. We've got anniversaries with Tom and Katie Howe and Jim and Nancy Say. Birthdays, Jackie Heinrichs, Bria Schmidt, Cheryl Patton, Rhonda Plautz, and Bob Wittenberg. Is there anything else from the church family that you would like to have us lift up in prayer together? Any praises or needs? See anything online? Everybody seems to be prayed up. Yes, Jared.
See a lot of black and gold among our members. As I just say, you know, God doesn't pick sides in these things. But I think we all just hope to see a well-contested game, and we know the Hawkeyes are going to make us proud.
Right on. Okay, good, good. What's the one's name that everybody talks about?
Kaylin Clark.
Kaylin what? Clark? I don't follow sports too much, guys. I'm sorry. But we did get, you got the win though, right? 2 points or something like that, I heard. So that's good. All right, when is the next game that we want to? Okay, there you go. So God, I'm definitely going to pray with much sincerity for, I'm just playing. Oh, that's great. Yeah, it would be awesome. Oh, we got one up here, Robbie. You could just yell it out.
We can hear you.
Yeah.
Spencer High School is opening a show on Friday, I think.
Okay.
The Girls, the play opens this week on Friday.
Okay, so for those at home who couldn't hear, Spencer High School has got a play, a show this week starting on Friday. I believe it's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday are the shows. So get your tickets, and we, of course, always have so many talented kids from our church as well as the community. To go see and support. So, anything else? Well, let's bow together. God, we do lift up all things in our life, whether it's travel mercies and taking care of those who are far from us, thanks for those who have returned. Perhaps there were things on our minds that we didn't mention but are heavy on our hearts, loved ones who are dealing with physical struggles, mental, emotional. And the things that cause us to come together as a community, like a basketball game, to celebrate together and to feel that special sense of pride of where we're from, who we are. God, in all these things, wherever we need you in our life, we just pray and ask that we would take time to ask you to be in those spaces. We wouldn't take you for granted, but we would want and seek your presence in all these things. And one way we can do that is to pray your prayer as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God, we bring you this blessing, and we ask that it be that. Let it go out into the world, into our church, into our community, and just spread your kingdom in all the places that it might reach. In your name, amen. Thank you, Alina. Okay, from our Old Testament, the book of Joshua. And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel at Shechem. He summoned the elders of Israel, its leaders, judges, and officers. They presented themselves before God. Then Joshua said to the entire people, "This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Long ago, your ancestors lived on the other side of the Euphrates. They served other gods. I took Abraham, your ancestor, from the other side of the Euphrates. I led him around the whole land of Canaan. I added to his descendants and gave him Isaac. To Isaac, I gave Jacob and Esau, but Jacob and his sons went down to Egypt. Then I sent Moses and Aaron. I plagued Egypt with what I did to them. After that, I brought you out. I brought your ancestors out of Egypt, and you came to the sea. The Egyptians chased your ancestors with chariots and horses to the Red Sea. Then they cried for help to the Lord. So he set darkness between you and the Egyptians. He brought the sea down on them and it covered them. With your own eyes you saw what I did to the Egyptians. You lived in the desert for a long time. Then I brought you into the land of the Amorites who lived on the other side of the Jordan. They attacked you, but I gave them into your power. You took over their land. I gave you land on which you hadn't toiled and cities that you had not built. You settled in them and are enjoying produce from vineyards and olive groves that you did not plant. So now, revere the Lord. Serve him honestly and faithfully. Put aside the gods that your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates and in Egypt and serve the Lord. But if it seems wrong, in your opinion, to serve the Lord, then choose today whom you will serve. Either choose the gods whom your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you live. But as for me and my family, I will serve the Lord. And now from our gospel passage in Matthew. Then Jesus spoke to the crowds and his disciples. He said, "The legal experts and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, you must take care to do everything they say, but don't do what they do. For they tie together heavy packs that are impossible to carry. They put them on the shoulders of others, but are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. Everything they do to be noticed by others. They make extra wide prayer bands for their arms and long tassels for their clothes. They love to sit in places of honor at banquets and in the synagogues. They love to be greeted with honor in the markets and be addressed as rabbi. But you shouldn't be called rabbi because you have one teacher and all of you are brothers and sisters. Don't call anybody on earth your father because you have one father who is heavenly. Don't be called teacher because Christ is your one teacher. But the one who is greatest among you will be your servant. All who lift themselves up will be brought low, but all who make themselves low will be lifted up. How terrible it will be for you legal experts and Pharisees, hypocrites. You shut people out of the kingdom of heaven. You don't enter yourself, and you won't allow those who enter to do so. How terrible it will be for you, legal experts and Pharisees, hypocrites. You travel over sea and land to make one convert, but when they've been converted, they become twice the child of hell you are." He's not pulling any punches, is he? "How terrible it will be for you legal experts and Pharisees, hypocrites. You clean the outside of the cup and plate, but inside they are full of violence and pleasure seeking. Blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup so that the outside of the cup will be clean too. How terrible it would be for you legal experts and Pharisees, hypocrites. You are like whitewashed tombs. They look beautiful on the outside, but inside they are full of dead bones and all kinds of filth. In the same way, you look righteous to people, but inside you are full of pretense and rebellion." Bow with me, please. God, I ask that you open up your word to us, to our hearts, to our minds, that hopefully you can use me to make some kind of sense out of the truth that you have for us this morning. Let it be something that we walk out chewing on. We all walk out working on. Maybe we don't figure it all out today, but you give us something to grow. In your name we say. Okay, so it's been a while since I stood over here, so I thought I'd bring back the good old dad Christian jokes. So how does Moses start his morning? He brews a cup of coffee. I just got two more. A priest, a rabbi, and a minister walk into a bar. The bartender says, "What is this, a joke?" I think on that one. And who was the greatest comedian in the Bible?
Samson.
Because?
He brought the house down.
All right. Got another dad with me. Good stuff. Thank you, Josh. Thank you. So today I'm going to talk to you about the suffering servant in the age of spin. The suffering servant in the age of spin. Now, what do I mean by spin? I mean it in a modern way, not necessarily just spinning a top or spinning a plate. Webster tells us that nowadays spin is the practice of attempting to manipulate the way an event or action is interpreted by others. I've got a clip to watch here that I think will help to drive this point home for just a moment. By the way, this is a joke. This is not real.
It's a very exciting time to be a brand. It's also a bit of a scary time because customers expect a lot more from their brands than they did in the past. During this incredibly necessary an overdue social reckoning that we're having in our culture, it is no longer acceptable for brands to stay out of the conversation. Consumers want to know, are you willing to use your brand awareness to affect positive social change, which will create more brand awareness? The question I ask the brands I work with is, are you going to be on the right side of history? The question isn't, what are you selling? Or what service are you providing? The question is, what do you stand for? Who are you, Bagel Bites? All these big companies, they're so scared of all this social change, and I come in and I put their fears to rest. You know, I tell them, just be honest. Tell your customers that J.P. Morgan is against racism, in theory. The question is no longer, do you want to buy Wheat Thins, for example? The question is now, will you support Wheat Thins in the fight against Lyme disease? And you've got a choice as a brand. You can hide and bury your head in the sand and hope it fixes itself, or you can roll up your sleeves and get to work and sell Butterfingers.
So our Pharisees are an example of this. This is another one. This is actually a product that you could buy at one time. I think it's discontinued now. But this is a spray-on mud. It was a real product you could buy in order to give your SUV or that bike that you had an authentic look of having been off-roading, even though you hadn't at all. So there are many examples of this in our culture. There are many examples of things being spun. Optics, not being really about helping or really about anything authentic, but just about the image. The Pharisees are an ancient example of this. Christ is coming down on them particularly hard because they're doing this. He mentioned tassels. Another thing that they had was a prayer box. You can see it in the middle of the one Pharisee's head. These prayer boxes were a practice and still are, along with the prayer bands that they would wrap on their arms. And in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with this practice. It's actually a kind of interesting traditional way to remind one to pray, to kind of follow through a ritual that just was helping them to get centered in prayer into their morning, into their day. But the Pharisees had taken this thing that was meant to be between them and God, meant to be an authentic way to help them to sort of pray in a more centered way. And if you remember from the scripture, they had made the prayer bands wider. They made the tassels from the prayer boxes longer. And it was no longer about what the prayer was about. It was about what? Perception.
Making a display of their faith.
Display of the faith.
Where's the show?
With who being the beneficiary?
Themselves.
It's not about who they're praying for, what they're praying for, not at all. But about them being the benefit of, say, the popularity, or how righteous they were, how educated they were, fill in the blank. One word that we could use to talk about the opposite of this would be authenticity. And it turns out authenticity is something that is being studied today. And it's more difficult, more challenging than you might realize. Scientific American had an article, and it says, it turns out authenticity is a real mess. The writer asked these perplexing questions. Are you being most authentic when you are being consistent with your emotions? Are you being most authentic when you are consistent with your beliefs? Which is the real authenticity? Was it the time you gave the waiter a piece of your mind? Or that time you didn't tell the waiter how you really felt about their dismal performance because you value kindness? The famous psychotherapist Carl Rogers observed that many people are asking lately, who am I really? And the latest research finds that most people report authenticity when they express compassion towards others or are living for something bigger than themselves. I don't know if y'all know this guy. There we go. You get extra cross points today. Awesome. Okay. Martin Luther. And Martin Luther is the guy that is credited with, although he didn't do it by himself, but he's credited with the Protestant Reformation, which of course we're thankful for because we're of that line. For about 1,500 years, there had only been one church. Which type of church was that? The Catholic Church. Martin Luther was a Catholic, and he was only ever wanting to reform the Catholic Church. He actually didn't want to break away, but he was so upset with the corruption that was going on inside of it, he had to write about it, he had to talk about it, and it ended up causing this explosion of reformation. And we have, but the last time I looked it up, if you average it out, the total number of denominations divided by 2,000 years, we've had a new denomination of Christianity every 3 weeks. It didn't actually play out that way, but if you take the overall number, there are so many different denominations of Christianity since the Protestant Reformation that we have one about every 3 weeks. Well, Martin Luther had this idea that he called his theology of the cross. He said that if you want to see what God looks like, because he was kind of noticing a trend toward God being about money, status, power, glory. And he said, that's not what the example in the Bible shows us. And he said, if you're going to pick one place in all time and space, if you had to just focus your vision on one spot, he said, it's the cross. The cross is the greatest revelation of God's divine nature. There is nothing anyone can do, say, or preach that will reveal more about God than the cross. So I thought, well, if he's on to something, and I'm trying to wrestle with what does it look like if I am an authentic Christian? How do I even know if I'm living out this thing that I say I believe in, this faith that's very important to me? How do I know? What is a test I can do on myself? If Luther's onto something, let's look at the cross. So I put together everything that happened to Jesus once he's on the cross and as he's being put on it. And a pattern kind of emerged to me. First off, there's suffering. There's a physical cost. He was beaten and whipped. There was the crown of thorns. He was spat on. Of course, the actual crucifixion itself. All of these things literally hurt his actual body, a physical cost. There was a mental and emotional cost. We see him cry out when he feels forsaken, even by his father, when he feels totally alone and isolated. He's mocked. They make signs. They make jokes at his expense. Aren't you the king of the Jews? Save yourself. And yet, while this is happening, he's serving. So he's suffering, and he's serving. He tells the two thieves on the cross, as they're talking to him, and the one recognizes who he is, that he is the Messiah, he tells that thief, today you will be with me in paradise. In the book of John, he actually tells John, the disciple, that his mom is, that Jesus' mother is now John's mother. And he looks to his mom, and he says, now this disciple is your son. We see him caring for others, making family, building relationship. We also see what my wife talked about with the fun months or now that we'll be waiting on the things. This is what he looks out to the crowd, to the ones who did the beating and the whipping and the crown of thorns, the spitting and the crucifying. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And then the only other things that I found as far as words that he spoke were, right before he dies, he tells God that into his hand he entrusts his spirit. He gives it all to God. And of course, we know even the prologue to this, he said, not my will, but yours be done. So we see suffering, we see serving. Now, we don't have time this morning to talk about all of these, and if you were afraid that I was going to, don't worry, I'm just picking one. I felt led to talk about the forgiveness part. I think they're all worth looking at and studying and thinking on. But I wanted to talk about the forgiveness, or at least I felt led to talk about the part of forgiveness. Now, when we talk about forgiveness, sometimes we can get confused on what it is. In its nature, it tells us it's a gift. It's for giving. For giving. It is a gift for us to give. What it is not is making it right. Okay, we call that justifying. It is not making the wrong right. We can't really do that. It's in the past. It's happened. It was wrong. It wasn't fair. It was hurtful. It was offensive. It's not making it right. That's not forgiveness. It's not erasing it from memory. I know many times we hear that we're supposed to forgive and forget. There is absolutely zero instruction in the Bible to forget. There's one verse that kind of talks about looking forward and moving forward and leaving the past behind. Maybe you could run with that, but it's the only one spot in all of Scripture. When we read about forgiveness, we don't read about forgetting. So I don't think that we're supposed to have to do that. It's not done when the debt is paid. Jared, in the banking world, if I owe a debt and I pay it off with interest, I completely catch up. Was that debt forgiven or was it just satisfied? It was just satisfied. Forgiving the debt would be what? It's completely writing it off. So it's not waiting for that debt to be paid and then doing it. It's not, you can do this sometimes, but it's not actually forgiveness if you sit down and you talk it out and you finally understand what they were doing and you see that it wasn't wrong to begin with. That is one way to reconcile, but that's not necessarily forgiveness. Forgiveness is not satisfying. It's also not reconciliation. Reconciliation takes two. Forgiveness just takes you. Reconciliation is your decision to continue the relationship, to work it out with the other person, however you do that, and move forward with that relationship. We are also not called in Scripture to do that in, say, an abusive relationship or something toxic. We can, and it is up to us, and we have that choice, and I think God can give us the power to do it. But we are called to forgive always. We are not called to reconcile always. So, what is forgiveness? Oh, I have this control, sorry. Okay, simply, literally translated, it's letting go. Hence the balloon illustration, just letting go. The word in the New Testament is aphemi. It's to release. It really is just letting go. In fact, many times, it's actually translated leaving behind. The disciples, when they're called, that same word will be used when they left their job behind. They left their nets behind. So we can think of forgiveness as just simply letting it go and leaving it behind. And it's perhaps more about your freedom and healing than it is about anyone else. Now, Christ says, forgive them because... how in the world could they not know what they were doing? Anybody ever wondered that? How could they not know what they're doing? That's insanity that they didn't know what they were doing was wrong. There is a lot of study on unconscious behavior. By the latest neuroscience, our brains are processing 11 million bits of information every single second. 1,001, you just did 11 million bits of information. But you're only conscious of about 40 to 50, okay? This from a journal, the unconscious way we perceive people during the course of the day is a reflexive reaction. We must exert willful conscious effort to put aside the unexplained and sometimes unwarranted negative feelings that we may harbor towards others. Sometimes people are doing what they don't realize they're doing. Sometimes we're reacting in ways and having prejudgments that we don't even know we have. And this can make a mess. But I go back to, how could they not know? I've been robbed more than once in my life. I don't know if y'all experienced that in your life, but I have been robbed more than once. One time was a particular painful one. I was in Galveston, and I went inside to eat some pizza, and my surfboard was in the back of the truck, and when I went out, surfboard was gone. It actually wasn't even my surfboard, I had borrowed it. So it was extra painful to wonder how somebody could have just taken this thing. Of course, I wished I had done better to protect it, but it was gone. I never saw it again. Another time, I had my car broken into, and the person who stole all, and I had left my money and stuff inside of it, which shows how smart I am. The person who had stole it left $1 on the dash. I've never known what to think about that. I don't know if it's funny or a slap in the face. I'm not sure. But he left $1 on the dash. How could whoever it was that stole the surfboard, how could whoever it was that left that dollar not know what they're doing? I don't have the answer to that completely. But I can tell you, Christ's example that we see through all Scripture, we think back to the tabernacle. There was so many laws and rules that you had to follow. But when you went to the very innermost place, the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant, where God's Spirit and presence was, that place where his presence dwelt was called the mercy seat. I don't have all the answers on how people can do the things that hurt us and that are mean, selfish, cruel. But it is clear in Scripture that we are called to forgive it. We are called to have mercy. So, I have another clip for you. This is from a Mr. Jim Carrey, who is, I don't believe he's a professing Christian, but in his later years, he has become a painter, and he has done a series of paintings of Jesus' face. And so this is a clip of him talking about his paintings and why he's doing it, combined with a clip of him at a gathering at the Sandy Hook United Methodist Church, which you probably know what that's about. So let's see what he has to say.
The energy that surrounds Jesus is electric. I don't know if Jesus is real. I don't know if he lived. I don't know what he means, but the paintings of Jesus are really my desire to convey Christ consciousness. I wanted you to have the feeling when you looked in his eyes that he was accepting of who you are. I wanted him to be able to stare at you and heal you from the painting. You can find every race in the face of Jesus. And I think that's how every race imagines Jesus. They imagine him as their own.
And ultimately, I believe that suffering leads to salvation. And in fact, it's the only way that we have to somehow accept, not deny, but feel our suffering and feel our losses. And then we make one of two decisions. We either decide to go through the gate of resentment, which leads to vengeance, which leads to self-harm, which leads to harm to others, or we go through the gate of forgiveness, which leads to grace. And your being here is an indication that you've made that decision already. You've made the decision to walk through the gate of forgiveness to grace, just as Christ did on the cross. He suffered terribly, and he was broken by it to the point of doubt and a feeling of absolute abandonment, which all of you felt. And then there was a decision to be made, and the decision was to look upon the people who were causing that suffering, or the situation that was causing that suffering, with compassion and with forgiveness. And that's what opens the gates of heaven for all of us.
God has given us an amazing, amazing tool. Almost a miracle, really. Forgiveness is something you have that can literally heal any wound, emotional, mental, psychological wound from the past. It can fix in a way, I'm not saying where it won't be there at all, there might be a scar. But it can free you from what that pain does. It is amazing if you think about it. It can literally free me from anything that's happened to me or anything I've done. Some of us carry more the offenses of others. Some of us carry more the shame of our own mistakes. Some of us do both. Forgiveness is a way free of that. So I call us to become examples of a true, authentic Christianity, of a faith that does the real gritty work to follow Christ's example and offer the world the real deal. Remember, Christ is forgiving the ones that beat him, the ones that crucified him, that mocked him, his enemies. I believe that an authentic, mature faith is the cure for the brokenness of this world, a world consumed with optics and the outside of the cup, a world that will spin anything so that it serves its own self-interest more than follow Jesus. Joshua asked the Israelites many years ago. He didn't ask them to believe in God. He asked them to choose which God they will serve. And I ask all of us, including myself, the same thing now. Who will you serve? Which God? Will you serve the God of consumerism, materialism, fame, or popularity? Will you serve the God of selfishness, self-righteousness, of being right, of winning? Will it be Yahweh or your way? Well, you claim to be Christian, but it's only a facade. And to make things even harder with so much unconscious behavior going on, how would you even know what you're truly being? So I give you one litmus test. Ask yourself, look in your own heart and soul, have you practiced Christ's example of forgiveness? How often have you looked in the face of those who have hurt and offended and betrayed and mocked you and been willing to offer mercy? Mr. Carey called it two gates. Joshua calls it different gods. But in the end, the point is the same. It's a choice, and it's up to you. Bow with me. God, I just ask that you would help us. This is a tough subject for any of us that have wounds that are still not healed, wounds that cause a lot of pain. We may not be ready to forgive yet. You didn't tell us that we have to do it today. You just called us to get there at some point. Be with us, God, and comfort us. Help us to either take a step towards that freedom, towards letting go, towards mercy. And when we're ready, help us to actually do it. In your name, amen. Church, in the benediction, we often say, go in peace, and I do wish that for us today. What we've talked about today is a way to actually have that peace, so I encourage you to consider it. Allison, I ask for forgiveness on not knowing Caitlin Clark's name. I'll study some more. Let us practice an authentic Christianity that looks like what Christ did and forgive one another. God be with us. Amen.